Okay,
Okay,
let's
let's
go.
go.
Hello, everyone. Every one person, I mean. Last time, about a month ago, we got some rotating parrots via plain old software rendering. And as we can see, it still works. And that's a nice property of software rendering. It just keeps working no matter what happens, what else happens in the world. Not necessarily true with hardware rendering. And the problem we ended up with last time was that we got it working, but in a very crude fashion, and we didn't really understand what is going on. So today we will try to get behind the math of everything a bit, at least as much that we kind of know what's going on. So we start with our matrix multiplication stuff. So that's the very usual way to do transformations for graphics nowadays. Just multiply your vector with some big matrix and everything works automatically. And you can very easily look up those matrices online, like what is a translation matrix, what is a rotation matrix. And when you then also look up how matrix rotation works and then just do the calculations for it, you will see that that's all basically just fifth grade math or even earlier. So rotation is pretty much the most complicated, where you have to do some sinus and cosinus. But the thing about all those matrix multiplications is not that it's what it's doing is complicated or hard to do, but it's just a very convenient way of doing it. And this whole matrix multiplication is just set up in a way that you can multiply those matrices and then use the result in place for what happened before. And that's exactly what we're doing here, because rotation normally is already a bit more complicated because you have to know what point you're rotating around. And what we're doing here is we are basically moving our parrot to the center of the screen, and then we rotate around position 0, 0, and then we move our parrot back to where he originally was. And we just multiply the matrices for all of that together and get one transform matrix out of it. And from then on, we can just apply that to all the corner points of our rectangle, which makes up our parrot. And that's also how you do it in 3D graphics and so on. It's just convenient, and you save yourself from doing this work over and over again. Oh, I have some crazy echo going on. Do I need more things in my room? I'll try to move a bit closer and speak quieter. Is that better? I hope, maybe. So, yeah, I can even hear it myself when I speak loudly. I'll be tricky. So, I'll try my best today, and I'll have to think of something for the next time to improve on that. Is it okay-ish now? It's a bit better. It's got better. Okay, I'm sorry about that. Let's continue. But there's one strange thing here. When you have a closer look, it's that we're using vectors with three components instead of two, even though we're just working in 2D, and we set the third coordinate, which is called Z here, but which isn't really Z. We always set that to one. That is called the homogeneous coordinate. And that's another convenience tool from mathematics, normally used for, or at least more popular in 3D, where we then use four component vectors. And it's especially useful for when you're doing projective geometry. And that's what we're always doing in 3D. We are projecting our 3D values onto a 2D plane. Now, we are not particularly interested in projecting 2D vectors on a 1D plane or something. But so homogeneous coordinates, what they mean is they are a slight, basically, this added value can mean two things. Either it means basically nothing when it's one, or it can be zero, and that means this point is very, very far away. And that then comes in handy in combination with matrix math, because a very, very far away point is basically equivalent to a direction, and we need those quite often in 3D graphics for our normals in particular. And with this, the math works out in a way that for normals, actually translations, when we transform and translate things only, are ignored when this value is zero. And if it's anything else, it basically doesn't mean anything. But when we go back from a homogeneous coordinate, and this is something else but one, we go back to our homogeneous coordinate by dividing all the other coordinates by this extra coordinate. This also means that when you have one homogeneous coordinate H, this is equivalent to 2.H via normal component vector multiplication. Like when you multiply every component of H with 2, you also multiply the last component by 2, and then it's the same again. And that is part of why they are called homogeneous, as far as I know. But all of this is basically just to make some mathematics easier. And one of the things that it allows is a translation matrix wouldn't even work without this additional element, which you can just have a look at by doing the complete multiplications which are in there. And if we can just have a look. The translation components go at the last column here in the matrix, And when you do all the additions and multiplications, you will see that that is only applied if this is not zero and only with, and in the end, then if it's zero, you basically just get an addition of those values to those values. So as far as I know, there's no deeper truth in all of those things. They are just basically tools which were made up to make the COM operations convenient and efficient. And of course, in a way that actually works and always gets you the correct result. And that's why we use them in computer graphics so much. And that's that. So that's not terribly exciting, but a bit confusing because it's not how we learned it in school. So that was this thing, how we do our transformations. Mondus, you mean I have two microphones? No, I don't. I can actually hear the problem myself in the room. I just need more things on the walls. Or an even smaller room. Oh, Tizi also meets feedback loop. Test, 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 test. Test, 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 test. Test, test, test. Wow, I think. I think you are right. I can hear more of my voice when I'm close to the microphone. Test, test, test. Is it now better? Test, test, test. Test. No, I can. Maybe I just have to position myself differently. How is it now? Yes. Ah, it's, just have to put my face somewhere else and it gets better, I think. Ah, it's all about the face. Okay, I hope that works out for today. Maybe I should do some tests before the next round. Where was I? So that were our transformation matrices. No deeper insights, at least from my side, apart from this being a convenient tool for doing these things. And the other problem we had was this here, where we actually rasterize our quads. And we use some function copied from the internet, which apparently returns the barycentric coordinates, at least according to this comment. And then we hack together some texture coordinates based on that. So when I prepared for today, my first idea was to actually sidestep that and do something more simple. That didn't work out, but I'll show you anyway what I had in mind. Let's go dark. Let's go darker. That's nicer, I think. What did I have in mind? So, consider a parallelogram. And the problem we were trying to solve is, given one pixel, we wanted to know whether this pixel is inside of this parallelogram, or so far it was just quads, but I think it's nice to support those two because they can look funny. So we wanted to know whether it's inside, and we wanted to know where we are inside of this thing. Primarily to get our texture coordinates. And if you look at that structure, the coordinates we want are 0, 0 for this position, 1, 0 for this position, 1, 1, 0, 1. And if you look at that pixel, the position for this should be, if we go down here with a line that is parallel to this line and to this line, and then we end up somewhere here. And this has length XL. This has length 0. And we want to know when we know the length of this. And we then, so L divided by the overall length of the side. That would be our texture coordinate in X direction. And basically the same thing here. Parallel to this and this. And we start with 0. Then we have a length here, and we have the overall length L epsilon, and we want to know this L divided by L epsilon, and that would be our texture coordinate in the epsilon direction. So I think that's you can basically see how that works out because when you do it like that, the texture coordinate would linearly move from 0 to 1 on this axis, same on this axis, and the texture coordinates would basically be like those lines which are parallel to the sides. And that's exactly what we want. So, and to calculate that, what we basically would need to do is take this point. We have the actual position for that. And we have this position. And then we would basically have to calculate the collision between this line and a line that starts here and is parallel to this. So that's also not that hard to calculate because we this vector is this point minus this, and then we just add this difference vector to this point, and then we have a line like this. Can go farther or not, that doesn't matter because we're interested in that collision point. So we basically have then two lines defined by two points each, and we want to know the collision. And then we would calculate the length of this, and then we would have our texture coordinate. And but then I looked up, because I was lazy, I looked up line intersections. So Wikipedia knows everything, and given two points on each line, exactly what we would like to have. And then we come up with this thing here, and this big D is this. And when we have a look at that, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Yeah, if we calculate it first, it's 14 multiplications. I don't even know how many subtractions and two divisions. And when we compare that to what we currently have, this orient2d, that does 1, 2 multiplications times 4 is 8. So even in this piece of code, which I think we can still optimize further, we are already looking better than with our line intersections. So that's why I didn't consider that further, because I was pretty sure we would end up being slower. So, which means we are back to our barycentric coordinates and have to kind of at least understand what that even means. And so we, of course, just go back to where it was invented. And it was invented in this book from 1827 from Mr. Möbius. And this is not Möbius the comic artist. It's also not Möbius the vampire. It's Möbius the mathematician, who also invented the Möbius strip. Well, he was one of two people who invented the Möbius strip in the same year, I read. And that's why you know his name. And so this is called der baryzentrische Kalkul, ein neues Hilfsmittel. That's rather funny when you know German, because it's pretty old style German. So, and in newer German, you can actually see my influence, because Klassen is nowadays in German written with a K. So that's progress. So the scan we have for that on Google. And one problem, it's all in German. Second problem, the scan is not the best. I think, yeah, it kind of seems to get progressively worse. But what's amazing here, even in the early 1800s, he already had links in his book, which you can click. That's pretty good. Very progressive. Yeah, but hard to read this thing where every third page is cut up. But that's how old this stuff is. And it all sounds rather funny. So, but to understand what's even going on, we start somewhere else then, with somewhere everyone can actually read. We start with a centroid, and also called the geometric center, and the centroid on a triangle. Can you see my cursor? Yes, I think so. So the centroid, you get that by going to each corner. So we go to the corner at the top and connecting it to the middle of the opposite line segment. So that is exactly the middle of this line. This is the middle of this line, and we connect those and we end up with this point, which is the so-called centroid. And it's also called the barycenter, or however you pronounce that in German, in English. German is easy for me. So that's a funny thing, that's because that's mainly used in astrology, where it means a bit of a different thing. So that's a center of mass of a system of planets. So that's not helping. But in geometry, yeah, it means the center of mass. That means if you would hold this triangle at this point, it wouldn't fall down if the mass is equally distributed on this triangle. And so in geometry itself, we are not really dealing with masses. So what we are, or when we deal with masses to make things how do you say that in English, so you can you kind of have a visual image in your brain of how those things work, then that is when we argument with masses in math. But what we then actually mean with it is areas, because we are not dealing with triangles which have varying mass distributions in geometry. So, and when the mass is distributed equally, well, that's basically like calculating with areas. So, that's a rather simple and related concept to barycentric coordinates. So let's look at the Wikipedia article of that once I got my pen.
Come here.
So here we are finally at the barycentric coordinates. Is a coordinate system, a point is specified by reference to a simplex. Though a simplex is the simplest geometric form in whatever geometric room you're working in. So in 2D, it's a triangle, and 2D is where we are at. Like in 3D, it's a tetrahedron. This thing, which is like a pyramid with a pyramid cut in half with just a triangle floor. That was too simple for the Egyptians, so they built pyramids instead. A point can be interpreted as masses placed at the vertices of the simplex. So we such that the point is the center of mass. So that's related to what we just learned. The centroid is the center of mass of the triangle per se, and the barycentric coordinates are the center of mass when you place masses on the vertices, so on the corners. Strange, right? So let's scroll down. And normalized absolute. So, is there a nicer picture here? Here are some barycentric coordinates on triangles. That sounds nice. So, in the context of a triangle, are also known as area coordinates. So that's basically what I was just talking about when we're talking about masses. And we're in actually in math, and we're in 2D. Then we're actually talking about areas. So equivalent to the sine trace. So that's interesting. The coordinates of P with respect to triangle ABC are equivalent to the sine ratios of the areas PBC, PCA, PAB. And what does that mean? That means I need a bigger drawing surface, much bigger. Now that's inefficient. No, not like that. Like that. And with that, no, don't scale. Can I do that without scaling? I think I can't. What a pity, my beautiful drawing is now a transformation matrix was applied. Whatever. We are back to another triangle. And we wanted to talk about those PAB and so on triangles this article talked about. So what they mean by this is the corners are A, B, C. And there is a barycentric coordinate called P. It's not poop, it's P. So, and the triangle, basically all the triangles which have P as one coordinate. So you have this triangle and these three triangles. So this one, and this one. And what did it tell us? So the coordinates of P with respect are equivalent to the signed ratios of the areas of PBC. Ta 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 ta. So that means if our point P moves this way, of course, this triangle gets bigger, and it means if it gets basically linear, so what was it? How do I say that correctly? So you can see it here, kind of. But so this is now confusing even me, but the point I want to make in the end is to calculate barycentric coordinates, you use those areas, and the extremes of the barycentric coordinates are A, B, and C itself. So at the maximum, the area of this triangle, or this triangle, or this triangle is equal to the area of our overall triangle. And when p is basically anywhere else, to calculate the barycentric coordinates, basically what you're doing is calculating the areas of those triangles, and then you want to know this is 2 times the area of this and so on, and this gives you basically the barycentric coordinate. This means 2 things which are important to us. One, barycentric coordinates like homogeneous coordinates, and actually they are a kind of homogeneous coordinates, can be scaled by a number and stay the same, because the barycentric is basically a ratio of those different areas. So you multiply it with one value, it stays the same. And based on the, and you do the calculations based on those areas, and your max values kind of are basically, is basically the area of the whole triangle. And now we still don't really understand barycentrics, but like the actual problem we had here to make this better was we calculated the barycentrics based on that formula for all 4 edges of our rectangle, and then we used basically the barycentrics of two opposing barycentrics were used to get the max value, and then divided one by this max value and got out something that kind of looked like a proper texture coordinate. But now, even though we still don't really understand what's going on, we now know that if you want to calculate this efficiently, you're somehow calculating the area of the triangle. And if you have a look at this formula, that looks suspiciously like those determinants you use to calculate triangle areas, right? So this is experimental programming, experimental math even. We now will do the most stupid thing you can do at this point. We calculate the area of our triangle, or even the area of our parallelogram, because we know that's twice of the area of the triangle. And then we see if that value correlates to the maximum values we get out of here. So the area of a triangle, you can, or a parallelogram, to the area of a parallelogram, you can look that up. But I, of course, know that by heart. I know that by heart so much that I can type it in quicker than you can see. So this is the area of the parallelogram. And let's see what happens if we just divide by this. And then we don't do this, but we just do if u is larger than 0, and and the same for v. So, do you think this will work? Or do you think it will look kind of strange? Interesting, right? So we hacked our way further and now we can remove the oaths. They are not used anymore. So, we still don't know what we're doing, but we're using way less instructions to do what we don't know. So, and this is what we actually wanted to do. And so this is the basis of our 2D graphics renderer we will continue to work with. And I think we should do some more math on that at a later date to verify all of that and get even deeper into barycentrics. But before we do that, I have to do that, and that's the actual problem here. But our result actually looks pretty good. So that's our inner loop now. It doesn't look too bad anymore. And so now that that is done, there's one more thing we wanted to do, and that is bilinear filtering. So when we go up here, and this is the part where, here is it, where we sample our image. And what we do here is normally called point sampling. We just round our texture coordinates, like we multiply them with the size of the image, and then we just round them and we get x and epsilon coordinates out, and we use them to index into our image, and that's it. And with that, our graphics will look like on PlayStation 1. Everything will be blocky because we're just rounding the texture coordinates, so we always just get one actual image value out of our image, no matter where we are, no matter how big we actually draw the image. So it will look blocky. So we will now also call this draw pixel point, so we know what's going on here. And we will just create another function so we can quickly jump between those, and that will now just call the other one. So quick test, so we can see we didn't do something silly. Still working. And now we do bilinear filtering. So renaming the function alone does not do the job, so we have to first have a look at what it even means. Still some space left. Now that looks stupid. Bilinear filtering. So, no. You want to draw a pixel right here, and you have a texture coordinate which is like 0.73 for x and 0.12 for epsilon. And you have an image is like basically a checkerboard thing of pixels. And this texture coordinate is mapped into our image. And it's like 0.73 is somewhere here, and 0.12, if we go from the top, it's like here. And if we consider, let's say those corners are our actual pixel positions in the image. So, and usually your texture coordinate will point you somewhere in between the pixels. Like when you end up exactly here, you just take the color at that position. But if you take get this position, then what we did before, we just rounded down and we ended up here and just use that position again. But with bilinear filtering, what you do is you take this color and this color, and then you project basically the point down here, and then you calculate a color value, which is the mean value of those two color values based on how close you are to this and how close you are to this. This is very similar to the alpha blending we did last time. So it's linear interpolation is what it's called. And then you do the same thing here. You take these two colors, and then based on the length of this and the length of this, you mix them together. You do again two linear interpolation between those colors based on how close you are to this and to this. And then you have two new colors, this color and this color. And then you do the same thing again with these two colors. And you, for interpolation, you take the value on the epsilon axis. So that's the same left and right. And you mix those two together, again using linear interpolation, this time using your epsilon coordinate. And then you finally get your color. And that's what we call bilinear interpolation. And it's quite annoying to implement. So, here we take one sample of pixel data. But we already know, based on our diagram, we actually need to get 4 out of that. So we do something like this first to get the coordinates of our 4 pixels. So what we're doing here is we're going down and we're going up. So our u value is between 2 coordinates when you multiply with the width, like it's, for example, 120.4. And when it's 120.4, the values we want to have are 120 and 121. And that's what we're doing here, if I didn't do anything wrong. Because here we are using floor, so we're going down. And then based on that floored value, we're going one up again. So that should give us our 120 and 121. And then based on those coordinates, we get our 4 pixels. And that's already pretty bad. So for every pixel we want to draw, we have to get 4 pixels of data out of our image, which we are drawing. Not nice, because data access and with how images are laid out in memory, that data access is even a bit problematic, because we're typically jumping a bit in our epsilon coordinates. So we have epsilon 0 and epsilon 1. They are just one value apart. But images, how they are usually laid out in memory, they are laid out line by line. So epsilon plus 1 means you are in the next line. And if your image is 4096 pixels wide, this coordinate here is far away from the other coordinate. With a 32-bit image, you are 4 bytes times 4096 away from the other pixel. So that's not nice for your cache behavior. And for that reason, actually, your GPU does not like to use linear image formats. Instead, they use tiled and swizzled, is it called, data formats. And how they actually lay out image data in memory, that's secret, I think. But they kind of rearrange it. And one of their reasons for rearranging is so that for bilinear pixel filtering, nearby samples also tend to be nearby in memory, so that the usual memory caching behavior works better with that. So, and when we have those 4 pixels, we then have to add a lot of code, because we have to do this stuff 4 times, and then we still have to do the interpolation between all of that. So first, let's get all of the color components. Looks like that. You see, I'm programming very quickly today. So that gets blue of the first pixel, blue of the second pixel, and so on and so on. So that's a bunch of code, which is not very exciting because pretty repetitive. And then we calculate the x position, which we use to interpolate on the x-axis, as we have seen on our diagram. And what we are calculating here is we are taking our hue position times the image width, what we also have done here, and we subtract image x0. So that gives us a value between 0 and 1, and that value is exactly our interpolation value. So when we get 0 for xx, that means we're exactly at that x pixel. And if we get 0.5, that means we're exactly between 2 pixels in x. And then we do linear interpolation. And that looks pretty much exactly the same like what we did for alpha blending down here. So instead of alpha, we take our xx and we take that the left color value times xx and the right color value times 1 minus xx. And if we do that for all those colors, and remember, we have to do it twice because we have to do it on both epsilon positions, that then looks something like this. And that's still not enough, because now we have to do the same thing for epsilon. So we calculate our epsilon pretty much the same way. And then we do our interpolation again. And here I calculate directly with float values. Actually, I started using float values further up. Like here originally, we only in the end calculated our float values based on the integer values that are actually in the image. Because you need your values between to be between 0 and 1 for linear interpolation to work that easily. So for that reason, already here at the start of all of this, I did this division by 255. That was the reason for that. And now we have our values here. So, and alpha is gone and A is a float. So we quickly change that. And that is now a test for 1. And we already have this one. And this is bilinear filtering. And let's see if things still work. See, copy and paste programming is the best. So, and I think there's still a bug in it, which I don't feel like searching for right now, because that doesn't look too good on closer inspection. But if you don't look too close, it still looks good enough. So there's probably something like epsilon in the wrong direction or something. Yeah, typical errors. But basically, bilinear filtering is this code here. I can't even fit it on one screen, maybe. Even then, I can't completely fit it on one screen. But this is how bilinear filtering works for textures. So, and the bad things are, you have to take 4 samples out of the image for every pixel you're drawing. And yeah, it's just a lot of pretty boring math here, because it's the same for all the components, and you have to get all the components out and shift the values around. And yeah, so it's annoying, but the aspect of it that's worse than that it's annoying is it's also pretty slow because of those 4 samples for every pixel, and because it's just a lot of stuff. And you can maybe imagine that that's one of the things where custom hardware to do that can really help speed up things. And there's one especially interesting aspect about that I wanted to show you. Do you remember the Xeon Phi? That was a CPU-like thing from Intel, which just had a lot of pretty small CPU cores. So 64 to 72, and those now current AMD CPUs also go up to 64 cores. But this was a longer while ago. Like here, it started in 2010. And it started with 57 cores. So those were pretty small. That was one aspect about it. But this whole Xeon Phi project was just a later offshoot of an earlier project called Larrabee. So maybe someone still remembers that. That was Intel's failed attempt at creating a high-end GPU. And Larrabee was quite different to GPUs of the day and also to GPUs we have nowadays. And Larrabee, we can't see it too good in this image, but Larrabee was a bunch of basically old Intel CPU cores, but they added very wide SIMD instructions to that. And we now have an offshoot of these SIMD instructions actually in current Intel CPUs. And those are the AVX 512 instructions. Those originated here. And I think that's also where the K registers originated, which are now in AVX 512, which you can now look up anywhere. And so it was basically just many CPU cores with very wide SIMD in, units. And so 512-bit vector processing units, those are the SIMD units. And it included one major fixed function graphics hardware feature, texture sampling units. So of all the things Intel did for this project, so the basic idea of the project was that with just a large amount of silly old Pentium CPU cores and a fancy software rasterizer, you can maybe kind of compete with actual current day GPUs. And it didn't quite work out, but I think it came quite close, at least close enough that they spent a lot of time with it and later brought a cutback variation of that to market. And with all of that, they decided that the one major thing that they can't just replace with regular old CPU cores is texture sampling. So what does that tell us? That tells us that this stuff is really slow in software, but can be made reasonably fast in hardware. That is a very unfortunate situation for us, and that's also the reason I will go back to point sampling for now. But we have it in here optionally for anyone who wants it. So we can do things to speed that up, of course, like on GPUs, could, for example, change our layouts of images in memory to make the access faster. And maybe we can also do something to get rid of all the shifting here, or at least make that more efficient. But still, whatever we do, it seems to be very unlikely that we can make it so fast that we are fine with it in the end. If even Intel figured that that's the one thing they need actual hardware for. So, and that's almost it for today. I just want to start a little bit with our performance analysis, because that's what we will do next time. We will make this thing fast. Well, at least we will try. So let's start. First thing to make your program fast, switch to release mode. That's rather important. So, and by that, we made it 10 times faster. Isn't that nice? Oh, we have to wait a bit. Does it still work? It still works. So let's have a quick look at where we're currently spending our time. Add more parrots. That's super slow, but that's nice for performance testing. So let's take like the last second. And we spent almost 90% in draw pixel point. 5% in floor. Okay, so 1% hier, 80% in set pixel. So that's not nice. I can't go here while I'm in that window. So let's go here. So, and if we have a look at that, this one does a very bad thing for performance, at least for something you do that often, like setting a pixel. It tests whether we are out of bounds or not. So, we should not do that. But the problem is when you write out of bounds in C, bad things will happen. Like anything can happen. That's really how it's defined. When you write out of bounds, that's undefined behavior. And the bad thing is it will usually do something bad with some other piece of data you have in memory. And like we've seen today in the chat, that can even mess up your allocator. And like the worst thing that can happen is that it overwrites some data without making it crash. Like it can overwrite a bit of data and then something is like wrong, but the program still runs. And after it runs for 1 hour, you realize, that doesn't look right. And you don't know what's going on. And it happened 1 hour ago. So that's the worst that can happen. But that's then the usual dilemma. We want to protect us from this kind of things, but we also don't want to pay for this all the time. And a very common strategy for that is an assert. An assert will still do this test, but it will only do that in debug mode. So, assert wants things to be true. So that's the opposite of what we put in here. So we want to assert that X is 0 or more. And we want to assert that it's smaller than the width, and the same thing for epsilon. So that's the usual compromise C programmers use. Now, when I build this for release mode, more assert undefined. That's not nice. Include assert. Does he like that more? Yes. So, and you can, look at that. Assert expands to nothing, and that's in release mode. In release mode, it just disappears. And in debug mode, let's see if we can see it. Yes, in debug mode, it does all the things. And what will then happen if we go out of bounds? The assert will stop our program and show us here, this is wrong. So this is not as nice as having the test in all the times, but usually you do a lot of debug runs and you see when something is wrong. So we now do a debug run and see if we stop at that point, and we don't. So likely things will also be all right when we run in release mode again. And hopefully things are now faster. They are still slow, but we will have a lesser look in a moment. So another thing you can see here is that this is declared as inline, and declaring a function as inline does basically nothing. For a C compiler, that's just a suggestion, because for the most part, C and C++ compilers decide themselves whether to inline or not to inline. But there's one big problem with inlining, and you may have noticed the implementation of this function is in the header file and not in the C++ file. Reason for that is that the usual compilation process for C and also C++ is that one C or CPP file is compiled, and then the next one is compiled, and then the next one is compiled. And in the end, everything is linked together. So to inline a function when it's not in the header file, but in the CPP file, inlining has to happen at link time and not at compile time. So that's a problem other compilers don't have. They don't have link time. They only have a compiler that does everything somehow. And inlining at at link time, that is something that compilers now do, they can actually do, and that's somewhere hidden here. Link time code generations, look at that. And all configurations, let's go to release. Aha, use fast link time code generation. So that means we actually wouldn't need to put it in the header for this to get inlined. And Clang and GCC have similar options. But there's one big problem with link time code generation or link time inlining or however you would like to call it. With big programs, it gets very slow. And Visual Studio is nowadays pretty good with its incremental linking. With Clang, it's still more complicated. And to just so you hear some numbers, when I enable link time code generation with Clang for CrossCode, with Clang there's some incremental option, but that's complicated and you have to save some files, and there's documentation about the results being different depending on what you do, and it's really strange, and I didn't bother with it because that sounded scary. And when I instead do a full link time optimization thing with Clang, that takes about 1 hour for CrossCode. So that's one of the reasons it's still pretty useful to put functions in headers when it's really important for the function to be inlined, because then they can also get inlined without that compile option. So with rather quick compile times. And like here, for example, for my Visual Studio projects, I usually create three different profiles. Debug, of course, is for debugging, rather slow, but asserts are on and all the stuff to make it easier to see what's going on. The assembly that's created doesn't throw out any variables, so you can still see them, and so on and so on. And develop mode usually is quite similar to release mode, but compiles much quicker. And that's what I mainly use it for. And for develop mode to not have that much of a downgrade in terms of performance to release mode, I sometimes decide to put my functions in the header. And why did I write inline here, even though I said that's basically ignored? So instead, I could write static. And that does pretty much the same thing. This tells the compiler that this function is local for this compile unit. So it doesn't create a name for the linker and so on. And each compile unit has its own copy of that, but that's completely irrelevant when you actually want the compiler to inline this. Because there won't be any copy left in the end anyway when everything is inlined. At least no separate copy. And the only reason I write inline instead of static is because Visual Studio tends to print a warning when a function is static but not used in any particular compilation unit. So that's the actual reason I use inline, to avoid the Visual Studio warning. Maybe it was a Clang warning. It was a warning somewhere. And that's why I write inline. So, and that's it for today. So we're getting to the questions, and TC asked something. Yes, you can do all. Titsy asks, could I place inline functions in separate files which I include in the header file? Would that lead to the same result? The answer is yes. And the thing about header files is that the compiler doesn't even know what a header file is. So what happens to the compiler is compilation of C code has at least three steps. First, the pre-compiler, as it's called, then the regular compiler, and then the linker. And what the pre-compiler does is those things. It handles the hashtags. Even though it doesn't run on Twitter, the pre-compiler does all those things like include, and like the most important, most well-known are include and define. All of those are initially replaced by the pre-compiler. That means in a first step, this pre-compiler literally replaces this line with the contents of this file. And based on that knowledge, you know what's possible. So the compiler, like the concept of a header file doesn't even exist for the compiler. That is just a convention. And as you probably have noticed, a header file can include additional headers. So it will start with the C file, because the C file is what the compiler sees initially. Then it will run the pre-compiler on that file that will see this line, or like this line. Then it will read in this file, but before it's done with that, it will first also look for those commands in this file and go down and down and down until it doesn't see anymore, and then it goes back, pastes in the text here, pastes in the text here and here, goes back, and then pastes in the resulting text here. It's a super primitive process. But thankfully, that also, I think, makes it pretty easy to understand what you can do with it. Okay, any more questions? Then I think that's it for today. And next time we start to really make things fast by parallelizing everything. And that means threading and SIMD instructions. And I hope that will make everything super fast, but we will see. So until then, bye bye.